morning.
Good morning.
It's good to be gathered together today. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm chapter 24. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it. For he has founded it on the seas and established it on the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in the holy place? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift their souls up to what is false and do not swear deceitfully. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from the God of their salvation. Such is the company of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Loving God, maker of this day, we are so grateful to be gathered here together in your house once again. Some of us come weary from the week that we've come through. Some of us come bringing anxieties and struggles. Others of us come bringing joy and excitement. And we thank you that we are able to bring all of ourselves before you today, every piece. We are grateful that you meet us right where we are, and that you have walked with us every step of the week that is finished, and that you will be with us every step of the week to come. Thank you for the ways that you sustain us and bring us to this moment. We are so grateful for your faithfulness, for your steady love that we can always count on. God, we give this service to you this morning. We ask that you would speak to each of us in new and fresh ways, and that we would not leave here the same as how we arrived. We give all of this to you. In your name we pray. Amen. I'm going to invite Amber to come light our Christ candle this morning. As we do every Sunday, we light this candle at the center of our gaze to remind us of the presence of the God who has gone before us, is here with us now, and will continue to guide us through the week to come. Lastly, you stand with me and join us as we continue in worship as your song.
Yeah.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from Matthew 23, verses 27 through 39. The word of the Lord reads, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of the bones of the dead and everything unclean. In the same way, on the outside, you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside, you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You build tombs for the prophets and decorate the graves of the righteous. And you say, 'If we had lived in the days of our ancestors, we would not have taken part with them in shedding the blood of the prophets.' So you testify against yourselves that you are the descendants of those who murdered the prophets. Go ahead then and complete what your ancestors started. You snakes, you brood of vipers, how will you escape being condemned to hell? Therefore, I am sending you prophets and sages and teachers. Some of them you will kill and crucify. Others you will flog in your synagogues and pursue from town to town. And so upon you will come all the righteous blood that has been shed on earth, from the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah, son of Berechiah, whom you murdered between the temple and the altar. Truly I tell you, all this will come on this generation. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how long I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. For I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
Thank you.
As we come now to our time of prayer, I invite you to take whatever posture of prayer is most appropriate for you this morning. As always, the altar to my right and your left is available to you when you come and to kneel at the feet of God. And the altar to my left, to your right, is available for you to come and to be anointed by Pastor Colleen. If you need a special touch from the Lord this morning, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we give you thanks. We give you thanks on this day for your goodness and your mercy. We give you thanks, for you are a holy God, but you are not a God who stays far off, but a God who draws near to us. A God to whom we cry, Abba, Father. A God who loves and cares for us. And on this Father's Day, we give you thanks, especially for those fathers who have loved us and cared for us and nurtured us. We think of our biological fathers and our adoptive fathers and our spiritual fathers, those who have gone before us and shown us how to live as your faithful people. And we give you thanks for these. And we ask, Lord, that you would bless them this morning. We ask, Lord, that you would bless all of us as we seek to follow you, and that you would bless our fathers as they seek to be examples of what it means to follow you. Lord, we lift up to you the many who are hurting and broken and grieving today. We think of those whose relationships with their own fathers are not good. Those whose relationships with their fathers are strained or broken or contain a lot of pain, Lord. We ask that you would be with them, that you would comfort them, that you would bring healing and reconciliation where it is possible, Lord. And for those who are grieving, Lord, we lift up those who have lost fathers in the years that have gone by or just recently, Lord. We know that this day can be a painful one. So, Lord, we lift up to you the many who are mourning their fathers today. We ask that you would bless them and draw near to the brokenhearted on this day. Lord, we lift up to you the many other burdens and requests that are on our hearts this week. We think of you, of Emily, who has been having difficulty with getting her sugar levels regulated. We ask that you would bless her and bring her healing and wisdom, that you would work with the doctors and all those who are caring for her to help her to feel better and to be able to get this under control. We think of Sharon, who's not able to be with us this morning because she is sick, and ask that you would bless her, bring her healing and recovery, and that we might be able to see her again, and that she might be able to come again to this space and worship with us. Lord, we lift up to you Bertha as she continues to recover. We ask that you would bless her, that her time in this long-term care facility would be a time of knowing you, of your blessing, of your love and your peace, that she might find you in this place and find you in the peoples around her and be you to those in need of those around her as well. Lord, for all those who are traveling this week and in the weeks to come, we ask a blessing upon them. May you bring them safe and secure wherever they are going. May they know your comfort and your love in the midst of their travels. Lord, help us to be your faithful people. to follow the examples that have been set out before us by our many ancestors in the faith. To follow the examples of those who have followed you faithfully. Lord, help us to be who you have called us to be. And so we pray as you have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I want to make you aware of just a few announcements that we have upcoming in the life of our church family. Happy Father's Day to all of the men in our congregation. We want to honor all of those who serve as biological, adoptive, foster, or spiritual fathers here. We have a small gift to show our appreciation to you after the service, and we hope you feel honored this morning. We are so glad that you are here with us. June continues to be a month of prayer, so we do have sheets out in the hallway if you would like to take a physical copy. But you'll also have prayer prompts daily via email and on Facebook, so we invite you to be praying with us throughout this month. We want to say a very big thank you to all who helped with Make a Difference Weekend. It was a wonderful time together of serving and loving our community. We want to say a very special thank you to Judy Myers and Kelly Hoagland for their leadership, and to the Hoaglands. And so we are so grateful, but thank you to all of you for helping us serve our community well. If you are a ministry leader, so this would be NDI, NYI, NMI president, church board secretary, treasurer, or a member of the pastoral staff, we are asking that you please have your annual written report submitted by today, if possible, or as soon as possible, if not by today. We're going to put those together in a booklet to hand out to our congregation next Sunday. And we want to thank all of our ministry leaders for your faithful leadership and service. And then next Sunday, June 23rd, we are excited to hear from our ministry leaders via their written reports. And we're also going to have a time of celebrating all that God has done over this last year. So we're going to put together a video of celebration, but we're really looking forward to that. So we would love for you to be here next Sunday for this wonderful day of worship and celebration together. At this time, I'm going to invite James forward. As many of you know, we had two teens that went to camp this year. James was one of the ones that went, and he is going to be sharing with us this morning a little bit about his experience at camp. Why don't you come here, because this mic's really hot. See you, Frank.
Man, it feels good to be up here. I don't know, what do you want me to say?
Just what did you enjoy about camp? What was your experience at camp?
Man, there's a lot. Is the mic working good? Okay, so I think what I liked the most about camp was what I learned. And I learned a lot. I learned that people put masks on. People put on masks to hide how they're truly doing. The only real person that can see behind that mask is God. And no one else can see it. You can't see it. You can't see it. Y'all can't see it. What's going on behind my mask? I can see what's going on behind your mask. But God knows. God only knows, you know? And so I learned that. Another thing I learned is you never really know what anyone's going through. So just be nice to everybody, right? Like, and then I liked water baseball. That was pretty funny. That's about it.
That's perfect. Thank you, James, so much.
Yes, man.
He had about 10 minutes notification that he was going to come up and do that. But we appreciate that. I know so many of you have been praying for James and for Anthony as they have gone to camp. And we ask that you would continue to pray for them in the days to come. And especially for James as he prepares to go off to college this fall. And so we're so excited for what God has in store for you.
And we're excited to hear from Anthony next Sunday about his camp experience as well. He's thrilled, I would say. At this time, I'm going to invite Danielle forward. As many of you know, the same week that teen camp was, there was also what is called the call at MNU, and it's a special week designated for those who recognize a call to ministry in their lives. And so Danielle was able to go to that, and she wanted to share a little bit. I asked her to share a little bit about her experience.
So yeah, I went to the call, which is at Mid-American Nazarene University, and I knew since third grade I had a call to ministry, and I ran from it ever since. And I have always kind of been running from it in one shape or another. And my first time running, I was like, I'm gonna be a therapist. We'll still help people, it'll be fine. And God was like, no. So I was like, okay, fine, we'll do youth ministry. I can do that, that's fine. Also, I had a wonderful example sitting right over there that taught me I can do that. And then God did the same thing. He was like, yeah, no. And that mostly happened during that week as well, where I finally was like, okay, I get it. Youth ministry's not it. Not children's ministry. I don't know what you want me to do then. Because I saw it as I have very few options for myself. And they're like, no, you don't have few options. Whatever God calls you to is what he calls you to, despite gender, despite background, despite your past, despite anything. And I was like, great, now I'm very confused. So I'm still exploring what that is gonna look like. But I do know that it is with adults now, and that I shouldn't be running away from that fact. Even though I am young and I'm not an adult myself, I should not be running away from that is the age group I'm supposed to go to. And it made me really realize, oh, God placed that and that and that, and that makes sense now. Yeah. And I'm thinking I'm finally just now accepting that. I have no clue what that's going to look like yet, at all, but we're figuring that out. So yeah, that was with that. Also, I'm very thankful for the call because it taught me that I need people as well, because I suck at that. I'm like, I got this. I can do X, Y, and Z, get it done, and I can execute things. And then God was like, yeah, no. And I was like, why not? It'll be done. And he's like, but you need people. You need a mentor to show you how to do it. You need examples in your life. You need to surround yourself with people that is good for you and can bring you closer to me. Because those people will take you far closer to him than you can take yourself. So I am very blessed that I met some people at the call who can do that for me, and who have shown me wonderful examples and have decided to force their way into my life to be friends with me. So, yeah, just a couple things. Also, I have an announcement. As I'm sure some of you know, and I want to thank all of the volunteers who signed up to help with the prom project that was going to happen this Saturday. I have taken the decision to cancel it due to lack of attendance and interest, but I do want to try to push this for next year. Now that I do have more of an idea, I have things set up, I have plans, I'm not going to be like panicking trying to get everything together. So yeah, that is what's happening with that. Yeah.
God is at work in the lives of our teens. I was so blessed by hearing from both of you, James and Danielle, and I know we'll be blessed from hearing from Anthony next week. But I am so thankful for the ways that God is moving and calling and continuing to raise up leaders in the life of the church. And so I am just so grateful for all that God is doing. I'm thankful for your prayers because I know you have just been covering our teens in prayers over these last couple of weeks. And so thank you. Let us keep doing that together. But we are so excited for what God is doing and what God has in store in the days to come. At this time, I'm going to invite you to stand and receive this blessing. Church, may the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us turn and greet one another with the peace of Christ.
It's like,
the
Everybody for your kindness and your greetings and all that, but I have a special announcement that 2 weeks from today, something exciting will happen. We'll get to share biscuits and gravy. Not exactly that, I mean that, but way more exciting is Dr. Danielle Hoagland has agreed to come back and share a Sunday school class with us. So we're excited to hear what she has to say to us and be praying for her in the next couple weeks that God will use her as he has. Ushers, would you come forward? And thank you for your generosity, not only in money, but time and resources and love. Thank you for being faithful as God is faithful. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we can't thank you enough for the amazing blessings that you give us day in and day out. And we pray that you would bless these gifts today. Bless both the gift and the giver. Amen. And there's a sign up sheet on the front pew here to sign up to bring something if you would like. And we encourage chocolate whenever possible.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Oh man, that was sad. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Yeah, there we go. All right. It's good to see everybody. Grace and peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. As always, it's good to be with you in this time of worship. Our text for this morning comes from 1 Samuel chapter 2. So right after Hannah's song, starting in verse 12, we'll read through the end of the chapter. It's a little bit of a lengthy passage of scripture, but I think it's helpful for the whole context of what's going on. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 12 through 36 reads, "Now, the sons of Eli were scoundrels. They had no regard for the Lord or for the duties of the priest to the people. When anyone offered sacrifice, the priest's servants would come while the meat was boiling with a three-pronged fork in his hand, and he would thrust it into the pan or kettle or cauldron or pot. All that the fork brought up, the priest would take for himself. This is what they did at Shiloh to all the Israelites who came there. Moreover, before the fat was burned, the priest's servant would come and say to the one who was sacrificing, 'Give meat for the priest to roast, for he will not accept boiled meat from you, but only raw.' But if the man said to him, 'Let me burn the fat first, and then take whatever you wish,' he would say, 'No, you must give it now. If not, I will take it by force.' Thus the sin of the young men was very great in the sight of the Lord, for they treated the offerings of the Lord with contempt. Samuel was ministering before the Lord, a boy wearing a linen ephod. His mother used to make for him a little robe and take it to him each year when she went up with her husband to offer the yearly sacrifice. Then Eli would bless Elkanah and his wife and say, 'May the Lord repay you with children by this woman for the gift that she made to the Lord.' And then they would return to their home. And the Lord took note of Hannah. She conceived and bore three sons and two daughters, and the boy Samuel grew up in the presence of the Lord. Now, Eli was very old. He heard all that his sons were doing to all Israel, and how they lay with the women who served at the entrance to the tent of meeting. He said to them, "Why do you do such things? For I hear of your evil dealings from all these people. No, my sons, it is not a good report that I hear from the people of the Lord spreading abroad. If one person sins against another, someone can intercede for the sinner with the Lord. But if someone sins against the Lord, who can make intercession?" But they would not listen to the voice of their father, for it was the will of the Lord to kill them. Now, the boy Samuel continued to grow both in stature and in favor with the Lord and with the people. A man of God came to Eli and said to him, "Thus the Lord has said, I revealed myself to the family of your ancestor in Egypt when they were slaves to the house of Pharaoh. I chose him out of all the tribes of Israel to be my priest, to go up to my altar, to offer incense, to wear an ephod before me. And I gave to the family of your ancestor all my offerings by fire from the people of Israel. Why then look with greedy eye at my sacrifices and my offerings that I commanded? And honor your sons more than me by fattening yourselves on the choicest parts of every offering of my people Israel. Therefore the Lord, the God of Israel, declares, I promised that your family and the family of your ancestors should go in and out before me forever. But now the Lord declares, far be it from me, for those who honor me I will honor, and those who despise me shall be treated with contempt. Look, a time is coming when I will cut off your strength and the strength of your ancestors' family, so that no one in your family will live to old age. Then in distress you will look with greedy eye on all the prosperity that shall be bestowed upon Israel, and no one in your family shall ever live to old age. The only one of you whom I shall not cut off from my altar shall be spared to weep out his eyes and grieve his heart. All the members of your household shall die by the sword. The fate of your two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, shall be the sign to you. Both of them shall die on the same day. I will raise up for myself a faithful priest who shall do according to what is in my heart and in my mind. I will build him a sure house, and he shall go in and out before me, my anointed one, forever. Everyone who is left in your family shall come to implore him for a piece of silver or a loaf of bread, and shall say, please put me in one of the priest's places that I may eat a morsel of bread. And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Gracious God, there are texts that are disturbing. So disturb us, that we might also find in these words your presence, a life-giving word. And so take these words and make them by your Spirit more than words on the page. Make them life for us. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, happy Father's Day after reading that scriptural text. We maybe should have thought about this a little bit more, putting this text on this day. Generally, every time I've ever been to another church and it's Father's Day, they do some sort of kind of pick-me-up text, a text that's easy. You know, you could select all sorts of great ones that sort of have a nice wrapped-up bow kind of conclusion. Everything is nice, easy to understand, makes you feel fuzzy inside, cheerful, happy, blessed. I mean, we could have done Psalm 23, we could have done John 3:16, we could have done Philippians 2, we could have done Ezekiel 37, the Valley of the Dry Bones, and how God can bring life from death. I mean, those are great things. We could talk all sorts of things about fatherhood or, you know, those kinds of realities and just pick a wonderful text. But we have this one. Some texts are really easy to preach, and then there's texts like this. It doesn't exactly look great. It's not a pick-me-up text. To use the language of Phyllis Trebel, who was a theologian, Old Testament theologian, it is a text of terror. It does not leave you with the warm fuzzies. It doesn't leave you feeling good. It doesn't say, let's go get the world now. It's kind of bleak. It ends in judgment. It seems harsh. And the reality is, it starts off in a very low place. The sons of Eli were scoundrels. Woo! That'll bless you. Sometimes, though, I do think we need to read these texts because they challenge us. They disturb us. Now, there is a way that we might read this text and just say, man, look at all the problems of Eli and his household, his sons. They are scoundrels, and nobody is going to argue that point. They steal, they're only self-interested, they're greedy, they're avarice, they're like voracious wolves. All they do is consume. They're only worried about their appetites, and their appetites are many. They are in it for themselves. These priests, called to serve the community, are only interested in serving themselves, and they have learned it from their father, the priest. He is somebody who has elevated himself in the community. He's not only interested in being a priest, but if you read the end of Judges, it says, in those days, Israel had no king. And in that vacuum of power, Eli asserts himself, steps into that vacuum so that he might not only be priest, but maybe he could also be king. He's seated on the Hakise in 1 Samuel 1, which is an odd place if you are in the temple serving to be seated on a seat that is a seat of authority and power, like a throne. That's where he's seated when you look at Hannah, who is on her face on the ground praying in a humble kind of attitude. And Eli, looking down on her from his dais, from his elevated spot, sees her mouth moving and interprets that as her being drunk and gets on to her. Get out of here. Enough with the drinking and the rabble-rousing that you're participating in. Go on. Don't you know this is God's house? And of course, she pours out her heart. No, my Lord, I'm not drunk. I'm praying. I'm praying because I have a child. So what Eli sees and doesn't hear, he misinterprets because he's not close enough to her to actually know what's going on. He just assumes. But now in chapter 2, he gets a report. He hears and he sees what his sons are doing, and he ignores it. His ears are closed when they should be open. And they're closed when they should be open. Say that again. His ears are closed when they should be open. And when they should be open, they're closed. Maybe that's a better way of putting it. In other words, his leadership is very selective. It's selective when he's willing to assert his authority in service. Because when it pertains to those who are most vulnerable, he's rather harsh. But when it is his family and himself that might benefit or be hurt by something, he's very selective in not doing much of anything. He lets his sons run roughshod over the people, and they take full advantage. They're not priests. I mean, they are. They hold that position of authority, but they are wolves. That's what they are. And the people are sheep for their taking. It's not a wonderful story. It's not an uplifting story. And on this Father's Day, if you were expecting that, I'm so sorry. It's not an easy text. What I find, though, that is really powerful about this text is that if we're really paying attention and not just seeing this as a Eli and his sons kind of problem, we can see that the kinds of realities of a religious community has often, too often, reflected the kinds of lives that Eli and his sons embody. That all too often, under the banner of God's name, all sorts of power politics of greediness, of taking and consuming, has been done by the faith community. It's not just simply Eli and his son's problem, it's a human problem. We're very much concerned about ourselves getting what we want at any cost. And we really don't care about others as long as our needs and desires are met. Our hungers, our insatiable hungers are met. This is the story of religious communities, Christian communities. There is a long, sordid, awful, atrocious history that has been the life of the church time and time and time again. It's not just Eli and his sons, it's us. We are the problem. We are surrounded by the things of worship, dealing with the holy things, much like Eli and his sons, and yet, even when they are close, in close proximity to all of those things, reading the scriptures, singing the songs, saying the prayers, day in and day out, as a religious community, and yet their lives do not bear out any witness to God's way in the world. It looks like every other culture and nation around them. Too often, when we have been surrounded by the holy things of worship, our lives don't necessarily reflect that we have had any sort of transformation. I think at some point, as the church, we've got to be honest with ourselves. We typically like to point the finger at the world out there and say, man, see how messed up they are? See how they're getting it wrong? Can you believe the ways that they've kicked God out of schools and except we love to point the finger at everybody else as the problem. And this deeper divide that some people are no longer coming to church, and so we get up in arms and start saying, well, we just gotta take the culture back. Right? We start to fight as much as we can to hold on to a piece of the pie. And we will do anything just to reassert our power in the marketplace, in the culture, in the world. We point the problem as out there, but maybe, just hear me out, maybe the problem isn't out there as much as it is an internal problem here with the church. Maybe the reason that the church no longer functions as a center of society is because society no longer can trust the church, because it looks like Eli and his sons are at the helm. Yeah. Would you trust them? Would you want to be around them? Would you avoid going to give your sacrifice, even though it was required by law? Would you not, in any way possible, make sure that if you went into the place of prayer, Eli and his sons aren't anywhere to be seen? Maybe you go in the off hours, at the very least. Maybe this whole idea that people are religious, but no longer identifying as Christian, has something to do with the fact that we often, too often, look like Eli and his sons. And I think it's time for us to start being honest about that history. Deeply honest about it. Not avoid and say we aren't the problem, but to own it. Even if we haven't been the ones that have done it, to own it, to say this is a problem. The history of the church is one that has been woven together with power politics in nations. And they have subjected and oppressed people because of skin color, because of national identity. Racism is a problem in the church. Eli and his sons, us, we have that problem. The church has often been one that loves to have great grand visions of things, to build and build and build. And yet, there are poor people sitting and sleeping under the shadow of the church, and the church refuses to help them. We have a greed problem. When the world is dead-bent on using power in its politics, the church gets swept up in it and says, well, I don't really care what that candidate has done as long as they vote the same way that I want them to vote. We have a greed for power problem in the church as well. And we have compromised time and time and time again so that when the world looks at us, they don't see Jesus. They see Eli and his sons. They don't see a community of service, but a community that loves to navel gaze, to worry about its own life, and who does not seem that concerned with the burdens that they bear. When did we see you, Lord? Whatever you've done to the least of these, you've done unto me. When did we see you naked, thirsty, in prison? Whatever you have done to the least of these, you have done unto me. That has been and will always be the very baseline of what it means to be somebody who follows God. God is so deeply concerned with those who are the most vulnerable in society. God is not interested in always attaching God's self with the powerful, but the powerless. Those who are willing to humble themselves, those who recognize their deep need, and those who often are the most powerful don't recognize that need any longer. They're interested in getting their own way rather than God's way. Abraham Lincoln, right in the middle of the Civil War, was having a conversation about the right and wrong kind of side of things between the North and the South, and it's a complicated kind of reality. We have simplified the narratives around Abraham Lincoln a little too much, but he was having a discussion with his cabinet, and they said, we just need to know if God is on our side. And he said, I'm not concerned if God is on our side, I'm concerned whether or not we're on God's side. That simple turn of phrase can begin to move us from being a house like Eli and his sons to being more like Jesus, who is the high priest, who came to serve, not to be served, who, though being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, held on to at all costs, but emptied himself and became a servant, taking on our flesh and dwelling among us as one of us. If I could boil this down for a Father's Day message, which I'm not inclined to do, but if I were to, I would extend this to all Christians. That part of what it means to be those as a father figure that is somebody who exercises some kind of authority over the lives of others, not in domineering and dominating ways, but what it means to be somebody who is a caretaker, is that we are those who have been called to serve and not lorded over others. And how hard and difficult that is. It is such a hard call to empty ourselves and not be swept up into the lies that Eli and his sons were swept up in. It's a hard text. But I don't want to dismiss it. And I don't want to point the finger at everybody else. There's the problem. The problem is here. The good news is that it doesn't have to continue to be a problem. Amen. God is willing to meet us in those places if we would confess. God, too often,
I have been more concerned about myself than others. God, too often I have been so fearful that I grab onto every power that I can to make sure my life is secure. Forgive me. God, help us to be a different kind of community. What's amazing is that in the midst of all of this vision of Eli and his sons and all the power that they hold, there's this little snippet about this little boy named Samuel, who was growing in stature before God and the people. It's possible in a world filled with Eli and his sons to be a Samuel. Amen. God is still in the work of calling us, each of us,
yes,
to be childlike in our faith.
Yes.
And to lean in, to lives of service for the sake of others. I'm going to invite Pastor Matt to lead us through our communion, where we are reminded that the one that we serve has come to serve us. And as those who bear the name of Jesus, this isn't about us. This table is open for everybody. It is a place of grace and gift. And we continue to pour ourselves out for the sake of others, because that's what God has done for us. Mm-hmm. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. What a powerful word for us, Christ Church. And as we come to his table, Christ our Lord invites us to this table, all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we might delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, proving God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are a forgiven people.
Amen.
On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread and gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. And likewise, he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offerings for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died,
Christ is risen,
Christ will come again. Let us pray. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. O Lord, make them for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry in all the world, until Christ comes again in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. If this is your first time to gather around the table with us here, we invite you, as we said earlier, we come down the middle aisle. You will be given the elements with open hands. You'll just receive them, say, "Thanks be to God," and return to your seat, and then we will all partake of the elements together. Let's come to his table and eat and be thankful. Would you come? Layer to reveal the bread. We think together of the words in the New Testament that remind us that we are adopted. Each of us are adopted in the Christ family. We are called his children, and we are beloved. For some, that may be a difficult reality. I am loved. You are loved. And so on that cross, Christ offered himself as a sacrifice. Take now and eat this bread to your soul's comfort and joy. As you peel back the second layer that reveals the juice, Jesus, fully God, fully man, the God-man, we emphasize often Christ's deity, and rightly so. And yet we think about his humanity, and that his blood, his physical blood, was shed for us for the remission of sins. Take now and drink to your soul's comfort and joy. Let's pray. Eternal God, we give thanks. We give thanks to you for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us stand and receive our benediction.
We serve a God who is gracious. May God teach us to serve not only him, but each other, that we might be poured out for the sake of the world. As we go this morning, may we go singing God's praises.
Praise God.